Hey everybody, welcome. Hope you got your coffee ready to go for this presentation about YouTube and Hovercast partnership. I am Chris, and I support tentpole events at YouTube, primarily for our largest brand partners, and help them create best-in-class moments using all that YouTube has to offer. For this session, I would ideally be partnered with my partner in crime, Eli, but unfortunately some illness has kind of taken over the family and has prevented him from joining us today. Nevertheless, for the programs that we'll cover as part of this session, Eli and the Hovercast team were essential to their success as their technology served as the backbone of the interactivity and gamification that we relied so heavily on throughout. Their contribution to these programs cannot be overstated, but I'll digress and do it solo. Let's dive in. So today I'm going to talk about two YouTube marketing and YouTube gaming programs and their own foray into the interactive live streaming space, and how we created two highly successful global programs that allowed viewers as a collective community to shape the experience through participation via YouTube's live chat. As YouTube and the internet in general has become progressively more social and content competing for our attention is seemingly infinite, finding new ways to communicate and engage with your audience is as important as ever. And the expectations that we set for content even proving worthy of our time continues to be a higher and higher bar. And for branded content, this is especially true for a Gen Z audience that has a strong appreciation for authentic brand experiences over that obviously promotional content. And so fortunately, we were beginning to recognize that interactive live streams drive really high engagement rates and therefore view time, especially on YouTube. And so when we were ideating on these programs alongside our marketing and gaming partners, the team kept this top of mind in order to really create an experience that kept more people more entertained and for longer. Before talking about what exactly we did and kind of how that came together, I'm gonna set the stage a bit for why. So YouTube's goal was to create a shared experience, really to celebrate global trends and culture and content for the year of 2021. Which seems like long ago, also seems like yesterday, which is a little funky. But after another odd year of isolation from friends and family for so many of us, online communities served as our main means of connection. And so we wanted to continue to build on that sense of community that existed on YouTube and had become so core to the overall communal experience that we had during a time where we couldn't physically be together. It was important to bring the whole world together at one time, and with live content experiencing significant peaks in creation and consumption, we knew that this moment also needed to be live. And though my peers, particularly at YouTube, are among the best creative minds in the business, the creator community on YouTube is incredible. So it was a moment to celebrate their amazing content, particularly throughout the year of 2021. And we wanted to empower them to uniquely and authentically participate in this end-of-year moment. That was essential to really allow them an opportunity to give back to the community that they had contributed to already so much through the year. And lastly, more importantly even, this was a moment for the viewers, the wonderful, engaged, global audience that is on YouTube, and we wanted them to decide what throughout the year was most worth celebrating. All in all, we decided, especially given the interactivity metrics and the way that the audience had leaned in to live experiences over the year while we were amongst that COVID experience, we knew that the only way to achieve this goal with a singular execution was to try to create the most interactive experience possible on YouTube. Thus, YouTube Escape.
Absolute mayhem out here. Put that shit in slow motion.
Oh, no!
Get in front!
Come on, get on him!
Seriously, we are doing this live like it's actually happening right now. Let's go!
Faster, brighter,
officially an interactive live stream that brings users around the world together to participate in a series of trends-based games that explore some of the biggest moments of 2021. Alongside Eli and the Hovercast team, and of course, many other partners that aren't represented here today, we created a 24-hour live stream, that was only 30 seconds of it, with three distinct chapters accommodating global time zones given the global audience on YouTube, and emphasizing localized trends for each region. So as people were experiencing their region's content, it was near and dear to them, not only in time and perhaps in language, but in the content and the creators themselves. Each segment incorporated live chat, call and response. As I mentioned, that was core to this experience and throughout, and you'll see many examples of that. It was paired with Hovercast's proprietary chat ingestion and graphics insertion technology, and ultimately allowing viewers it's just a thumbnail for a moment. Anyway, don't worry, no technical difficulty here, just a paused video. Allowing viewers to directly influence and, in many cases, create the show that they most wanted to see. The audience participated in mini games, trivia, polls, and live triggers to help determine what would happen next, and ultimately unlock finale moments like exploding volcanoes and Minecraft concerts featuring BTS and Måneskin. Now, through the rest of the presentation, I'll discuss interchangeably the creative strategy, the launch, and the ultimate success of both YouTube Escape, which you just saw a video for and I kind of teed up at the beginning, as well as a gaming program called YouTube Game On. This was an equally interactive live stream celebrating the top gaming trends of 2022. But ultimately was an optimized version of Escape based on that experience and feedback from the first program, and in almost every way was a more gamified, customizable, and communal experience for the YouTube audience. So when we look at some of the interactive formats that we supported through these programs, we stack rank them in terms of the true level of influence that an audience has in a segment's outcome. This ranges from the truest form of influence, which we call personalization, obviously, where without audience participation, the show simply cannot proceed. With the bottom of the stack representing simpler playback of video with integrated graphics to encourage communication and reward viewers who have fun or otherwise interesting messages worth highlighting to the global audience. And to illustrate where each segment kind of fell within this hierarchy, we created a tiered list, which is hot these days apparently, with some of our favorite bits. Representing the highest level of interactivity again, this time in the form of personalization, we had opposing views of competition versus collaboration. For competition, the audience, the world, literally raced one of the top solvers to complete a series of crossword puzzles in real time. On one of the puzzles, Stella, one of the top world crossword solvers in the world, beat the entire global audience by a full minute. But don't worry, we redeemed ourselves. We won 2 out of 3 against Stella. Now, but with for collaboration, to bring everyone together, which we'll actually watch this in a minute, it's pretty cool, we had Harry Mack, a freestyle rapper extraordinaire, run verses using words and topics suggested by the audience, again via live chat, again in real time. To control the show, taking it a step slightly down in the interactive scale, we had voters to determine winning, like which room a character may navigate into next in a haunted maze, or how to hinder a professional simulation driver, whether she was blindfolded or had to drive the vehicle in reverse during a race. Then we had some ways to influence the show, albeit with a slightly lower level of interactivity, like filling a meter in order to launch a finale moment. Still required user activation, but how far it would take that that level of impact was a little bit less than some of the higher interactivity moments. There were guessing games like Real or Cake. There were predictions like Real Life Among Us. And finally, though much easier from a technical perspective, but no less exciting for the audience, we had featured messages flown throughout each of the broadcasts, and specifically during our grand finale moments, a BTS concert in the world of Minecraft. And for many, especially the most diehard BTS fans, and there are many, this is akin to seeing yourself on the Jumbotron at a big game. Now let's check out Harry Mack. Yeah, apologies for that.
Very moment, like seriously, we are doing this live, like it's actually happening right now. Live from the city of Los Angeles, these are your words. If you want your word to enter my live rap, all you gotta do is drop it in the live chat. I got a couple more minutes to rock for y'all. Let's get it. Yeah, come and get with it. Y'all know that my lyrics will reach you. And when they're coming to rap, and most of them cheesy, just like a pizza. Yeah, I'm back up on it, and my bars are the cleverest. Astounding when I bring you to the peak of Mountain Everest. Yeah, so come and get it, dog. I ain't no dummy. I'm stacking up my paper steady, getting to the money. Yeah, I put it on, yeah. I said it's steamy like a sauna. Harry Mack be a lyrical monster. I'm like the boogeyman. I'm sweet like some cookie man out the oven. I got the flow, they love it. Compared to all these rappers in the game, I'd be better. And when you try, yo, your brain's dry like a desert. What? Oh my goodness.
Really great video. That's an incredible segment. It actually lasted about 5 minutes of him just constantly kind of freestyle flowing against those same types of terms that were surfaced in front of him in real time. Though that Google chat ping sound constantly kind of gives me nightmares. At a high level, the feedback loop required to create these experiences, relatively straightforward. You share a prompt asking for the audience to engage in a certain way. The audience participates based on a series of options, sometimes really limited, like A, B, C, D, sometimes super open-ended, and then based on the decision-making criteria associated with a given choice that you've predefined, you react in real time to display the results and help curate the show. And finally, the audience sees right in front of them and is able to reap the benefits of their participation. And if we take it a step further, we were able to create dozens of segments and truly countless possibilities in terms of the order in which they could appear, whether they would appear, how they would appear, by simply modifying the prompt language associated with just three primary widgets, again supported by the Hovercast technology. Polls, meters, and featured chat served as the powerful tools that enabled us and specifically enabled the audience to directly influence the show throughout. So how did we actually make this happen from a technical perspective? Well, first of all, with a very solid connection between YouTube's live chat API and Hovercast's interactivity technology, as well as a video production team that could run with decisions as they were being made, really on their toes throughout. And we haven't really talked about the scale of this program, but we actually had to do this because of the language-based localization, which we'll talk about, times 8 across this program. So step 1 was ingesting live chat data directly into the Hovercast platform and merging that information from 8 unique broadcasts into one unified experience. Chat curation happened within the Hovercast UI, where messages could be selected, basically stacked ranked in terms of high quality, and whether or not they were high enough quality to be featured, and all votes were counted in real time in an automated fashion. Those types of votes and user activity also influenced Hovercast graphics, whether it be floated messages, which was very manual, or poll-based meter systems that were automated, again, based on the way that the graphics were built. And then from a creative decisioning process, perhaps the most complicated version, the show caller needs to recognize what decisions were being made in real time and ensure that the video that plays back reflected that, again, times 8 across the show. So if we take another look at kind of the creative decisioning associated with it, obviously, we wanted Escape and Game On to be truly authentic experiences, with viewers influencing, again, the segments in real time. But the style of much of the content meant that it really couldn't be produced in a live capacity. So we had to review each concept and determine which segments could actually be pre-recorded without sacrificing the authenticity of the experience, knowing that at the end of the day, based on user choice, some of that content would never see the light of day. But because it was ultimately the audience's decision, and that was the experience that they wanted for themselves, that was okay. So with a collection of pre-recorded segments and mixed in live shoots, a massive decision tree was built representing all the various choices and the results that could come from that, ensuring we were prepared and comfortable with all possible outcomes. While many of our segments supported linear playback of the video and customization purely based on graphic overlays, others involved significant decision making forcing a technical director to, again, react in real time. One example is Olivia Rodrigo's Choose Your Own Remix segment, as you can see some of the imagery here. And so basically, viewers were able to choose exactly which remix of the hit song Driver's License they wanted to hear, whether it be pop, punk, or country, for example. And the audience had no idea how many of the remixes they'd actually have an opportunity to hear. And in the end, only one of the four options was omitted. But this illustrates the exact type of feedback that'll really keep a technical director on their toes and ensure that they are able to accommodate the experience that the viewer is requesting. It's important also to note that we received absolutely no backlash about the existence of pre-recorded content. This is likely a reflection of the high quality of the content itself and the fact that the pre-recorded segments did not at all hinder the audience's ability to actually influence the show. So you can find a really solid balance between live, and pre-recorded without introducing unnecessary risk or avoiding content that simply can't be pre-produced. I mentioned this previously, but given our commitment to creating an experience that was inclusive for folks around the globe, we needed to maximize accessibility for geographies and in languages where significant participation was expected. And to do so, we decided to create language localized streams across 8 languages: English, French, German, Indonesian, Japanese, Korean, Portuguese, and Spanish. This inevitably introduced a lot of complexities across creative, across production, and technical work streams, basically across the board, especially balancing the fact that we really wanted to maintain that singular global experience across the whole program. And so for production, this meant show calling and playback timing had to be consistent across 8 unique transmissions. A decision is made, they need to fire the right video across multiple shows at the same time. For search and discovery, this presented challenges where we needed to really clearly communicate to viewers which streams were available and how they can find them. And if they landed in the wrong place, how can we send them to the right place based on the language stream that they were looking for? For live chat and its ingestion, this required Hovercast to merge multiple API feeds into one instance to ensure all votes counted the same and contributed to that single global experience. And from a community engagement and moderation perspective, this basically just meant 8x effort across 8x languages, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit. As most of us who are involved with streaming in any capacity, we are intimately aware that there's inherent risk associated with any live stream, let alone one that is highly interactive and influenced by an audience. So when you're really just getting your feet wet and considering interactivity for any live program, we do recommend the following steps to minimize risk and have you feeling confident going into a live stream like this. First is de-risk the creative. I mentioned where we needed to be comfortable with all of the possible outcomes. And in order to do that, you need to figure out a way to represent all of the possible outcomes and evaluate them on a one-to-one basis so that you're both prepared to execute and ultimately comfortable with that end result. For contingency planning, you need to plan for the worst. Some obvious things are hardware and network redundancy. But in the course of interactivity, bailout plans. What if Harry Mack's internet dropped during that segment and we weren't able to surface those chats? We had to create a bailout plan to ensure that we were ready to pivot at a moment's notice to some of the pre-recorded content while simultaneously messaging to viewers, hey, don't worry, we'll be back to Harry Mack as soon as we can. And then we just needed to make sure that, the in-broadcast messaging is solid and consistent and is something that can be included across all 8 streams in this particular case, again, so the viewer is very aware of what's going on when it happens. And then from a moderation perspective, make a plan and act accordingly. And if we want to expand on that just a touch, we recognize how important it is to remain brand safe across all online channels. And the idea of opening up the floodgates of live chat can seem really daunting at first. We understand there are a lot of trolls online, you never know what they're going to say. But fortunately, there's a wealth of moderation tools that can be used to monitor sentiment, discourage bad actors, and ultimately help keep the narrative positive and on brand. YouTube's automated tools, which are strongly recommended for any creator and apply to all content, live and VOD, include channel-wide blocked words and a review mechanism allowing questionable messages to be held privately until they're deemed relevant and appropriate for the audience. Human moderators are a great great for real-time action, particularly to fill any gaps that may have been missed by automated systems due to lack of comprehensiveness, or just to simply deter bad actors from ruining the experience of others. Basically, you know it when you see it. You didn't plan for it via the blocked words list, but you can still act in that moment. You can even block bad actors from participating in the chat without them knowing that any action has been taken against them, which is pretty funny if you picture that those users are just like speaking into a void, but being none the wiser that no one else can hear what they have to say. And finally, of course, a technology like Hovercast and several other third-party providers are great examples of third-party technology that can be additive to the YouTube feature set and massively expand your capabilities for delivering an engaging and brand-safe experience for everyone. And so there's a lot of like technical components to this, but ultimately, without diving into the weeds too much on the performance side of things, like social sentiment and media response, video-level data actually indicates a really positive reception by many viewers on YouTube. Highlights include strong viewership exceeding 40 million, an incredible volume of chat messages in the millions ingested by Hovercast via YouTube's live chat API. Those messages are what ultimately influenced each segment in the many ways that I've already discussed. And to further emphasize the regular influx of chat messages that we were experiencing in real time, a call and response segment about a heat map representing kind of the global diversity of the program, as you can picture just a globe with like heat spikes, over 38,000 messages came in a single minute. And we had multiple other peaks throughout both shows that exceeded 10,000 messages or more in 1 minute. So all this to say, Escape and Game On served as incredible proofs of concept for how successful interactive live streams can be on YouTube for the audience and to keep them engaged. But an amazing thing was that it was also really well received off platform, both in press and in public social engagement. The viewership and engagement metrics, again, speak for themselves, but what was really thrilling about this is the strong reception on social and from our partners in the awards community as well. We surpassed sentiment and traffic benchmarks, suggesting YouTube Escape and Game On were hits. And we were fortunate enough to be nominated for multiple awards, winning 2 Webbies in the process. Organic traffic of 1,300% of comparable benchmarks is pretty insane. So why would you want to create an interactive live stream? To summarize, and we've probably covered some of this already, one is performance. Interactive live streams boost engagement stats and increase watch time. If you bake in interactive moments with consequential decision points, your audience will love it and your metrics will pop. Marketing, the innovation around interactive live streaming helps you stand out amongst a very competitive creator landscape. We mentioned the wealth of videos that exist on YouTube alone. These types of shows may even be low-hanging fruit for creative awards or just respect in the creative community in terms of their cutting-edge nature. From an audience perspective, you can essentially create or turn viewers into superfans. They give your audience a stake in the content by offering a chance for them to make a real difference in the content itself. And their superpower is that as they become super fans, they can leverage their good words about your program and create even more fans. And then finally, from a creativity perspective, it's increasingly important to really remain on the cutting edge, and the ability to create first of its kind programming in the kind of interactive landscape is really prime for the taking. We're just scratching the surface on what an audience-powered live stream can be. Thanks. We do have a couple of minutes for questions. We've got one hand up already. I'd love to hear it. Yeah, that's a. I can. So yeah, so just to quickly restate, I mean, with online video in general, there's some form of latency. If you're multiplying out the number of streams, the variation in that latency could be very different. How do you account for that, as well as ensuring that, you know, basically the meters, the vote metrics, the graphics, the prompts are all timed according to the actual viewing experience? Is that fair? Cool. So first of all, planning for it. We knew that there'd be some level of latency purely from like production and coding side to YouTube, let's call it 30 seconds. And so what we needed to do is ensure we weren't floating graphics so far ahead of time that the viewer hadn't received the prompt by the time results start to show. So you buy yourself a bit of a buffer there to allow for some response to trickle in, so that when you finally throw kind of the results meter, even though it's adapting to more responses, it's not just zeros across the board, even though the prompt happened 30 seconds ago. That's one. Two is just recognizing that that latency and the variability across multiple streams exists. So further buying your time to allow basically, you had to create videos that were compelling enough as standalone so that you could buy enough time without experiencing viewer drop-off and allow them, you know, maybe 2 minutes or so to actually respond.
So you had the whole audience at least 30 seconds back from July.
Yeah.
Were they kept synchronized with each other if we were all watching?
Roughly. I mean, synchronized enough that it didn't, because we baked in some buffer each way, it didn't impact the experience. Exactly.
Things like sports betting, that's
hard to do. Yep. Yes, please. So, yeah, probably. I think, especially when you talk about the scope. So, sorry, the question was, are there any UX challenges, particularly even comparing VOD versus live? So, from a search and discovery perspective, this one was particularly challenging because of the multiple streams that were available to viewers. So we really needed to utilize some of the YouTube capabilities like playlists and featured videos, as well as description and even title language to make it explicitly clear, hey, where are you? What language is this? And where should you go if this isn't your primary language or the experience you're looking for? So that's one. It also resulted in the prompts being posted in the non-English languages for the non-English streams in live chat as well, which is something that I didn't speak to, but it was a way for us to further localize since the in-broadcast graphics were all in English. VOD versus live, I think instead the challenge is more pre-recorded versus live, but still appearing as a live experience. Now, the YouTube audience overall has become very familiar with that behavior, so as long as you're not trying to fool them and say, this is live, when it very clearly is not, they seem to be very receptive of it. So not so much a UX change, but certainly a creative decision to not be in their face saying it's live when it's not. All right. Chat after? I just got time.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.